So, Revelation 7 verse 9 said that after this I beheld and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palm in their hands. So my question is this: this great multitude that no man could number is the only specifically for the Jewish people, or it is the universal believers, or it is the elected ones of God?
Sister Jelle or Sister Angelica, could you write down his questions so I have a list of them? Okay, so if it's just one question, it's easy to answer. The answer is found in the verse. Out of all nations. Is that just Jews? No. All nations. If it's all nations, that means to say all kindreds of people. I have a subject called the Gentile tribe. What does the word Gentile mean? The word Gentile, let me write from where. So, make sure, Sister Irish, this to be read. The word.
What does that mean?
What does it mean? The word Gentile, what does it mean? You forgot. The word Gentile means nation. So out of all nations, out of all Gentiles. Now is the Jewish nation also the Gentile nation? Yes or no? Answer.
Yes.
So, it's misunderstood in Christian circles that the word Gentile means a non-Jew. But if you look at the root word, it means nations. So when you read in the Old Testament, the Gentiles, the Jews were speaking among themselves, other nations. Say the nations. They're referring to outsiders from their group. But it does not mean the word Gentile means non-Jew. It just became a connotation. The original meaning of the word Gentile is nation. So the Jewish nation is included in the word Gentile. So when you say Gentile bride, the bride did not just consist of non-Jew. The Gentile bride includes the Jewish people. Now, God took a certain number, not majority, a small number out of all nations. What you read in Revelation chapter 7 is an example of the bride, and is an example of the foolish virgin. It's an example of the tribulation saints. That it has many parallel applications. So, the question, does that refer to non-Jew, or does that refer only to the Jew? It refers to all. Now, let's talk about the 144,000. I'd like to extend my answer to that. Then you can ask your question again. Is the multitude of nations composed of the 144,000? Wrong. 144,000 has been mentioned earlier. Then there is another mixed multitude. They are parallels, martyrs in the tribulation. There are Jewish martyrs in the tribulation. Like, could you flash, Sister Jelai, the tribulation period? There are also martyrs of non-Jewish, or what we usually call Gentiles. In the message, they call that the foolish virgins. Well, not all foolish virgins, but those foolish virgins who would have repented from their foolishness. So, I've extended my answer to several aspects. So right now, let's give another question. Who among you have a second question?
So the question is, during Abraham was called by God, is he from Ur? Remember Ur?
Yes, yes.
Ur is...
Can you flash the map? Sister Delay. Map of the Middle East, Ur.
Ur...
Search it in Google.
Is Gentile nation. It is a Jewish nation.
If the picture is flashed, show the picture, okay?
Then, because during after the flood, or
when Ur,
the Tower of Babel was built, then it was scattered. So you cannot pinpoint which is the Gentiles in the Jew.
There's no Jew during the dispersion.
Because Abraham was
To be strict with the word Jew, where does it come from? Brother George, you know?
From Judah.
From Judah. Did Judah exist? No.
Yes.
At least you can call him a Hebrew. Scofield calls Abraham a Gentile king. You don't have a microphone. You have to come near there. You don't. Father Francis. Okay, so rely on that.
Abraham is not a Jew.
So,
but during his time, he is a Hebrew.
So, there is no Jew yet, technically. There are Jews predestination-wise. It's in the seed. It's in the belly. It's in the womb. So, not yet born. Not yet existing as a nation. Okay, next question. Sister Ann was the first one.
Hello. Prophet, my question is about the original scriptures of the Bible in Matthew 28:19.
The original what?
The original manuscript of Matthew 28:19. The original manuscript of Matthew 28:19, it is written that in my name.
So?
But in the King James Bible, it is written
in the name of the Father,
the Holy Ghost.
So?
So, between the two, what is the true interpretation?
I couldn't definitely say anything like he was wrong there. But this is what I can say. It is easier if you could understand the King James that it does not promote a unbiblical trinity. You understand unbiblical trinity? Unbiblical trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, three separate persons. So the biblical trinity, there are three of them. Three words, three titles, three manifestations. 1 John 5:7. It does not exist in other scriptures, in other modern versions. There are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Spirit. And these three are one. Is there any problem with one? The next verse says, "There are three that bear record on earth: the water." The Spirit and the blood. And these three agree in one. And you say agree in one, you can say, oh, they are trinity of persons agreeing with each other. But if King James, 1 John 5:7 says these three are one, it settles it, no problem. It did not say the Son, it said the Word. When you say the Son, you could go into extreme oneness. It didn't say the Son. It said, the Word. There are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Spirit.
The Word is
so,
the Father is the Word.
The Word does not mean another person, another being. They are one as the Word and God are one. Because that Word was not yet expressed as another being. So there's no problem with that. There is no contradiction. It does not support a Trinity, nor does it support an extreme oneness. Directly, categorically. It's an open-ended scripture, and if you corroborate it with other scriptures, then you get the right Godhead. Still one God, but He is not His Son. Okay? The Word is not yet the Son. The Word is different from the Son. The Word, when it was made flesh, it was the Son. But the Word in itself, which is God's expression, is still there. It's abstract, it's logos, it's the mind, it's the revelation, it's the hidden plan. You don't look at the flesh of Jesus Christ, you look at God's hidden plan, why He is here on earth, why He came out from God, why He was born, why He died, why He was crucified, He was resurrected. Then you understand the plan, then you go become part of God's plan. If you only look at the Son as the flesh, and you make up all kinds of ideas about the Son, then you are no different from others. Catholics, Protestants, Pentecostals, others who come short of understanding. You need to be progressive in your understanding. Okay, let's continue. Other question. Did you, Brother Sister Angelica, are you writing down the questions? Give it to me later. Next question.
My question is about the Holy Ghost. According to your explanation and some other scripture, the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of God and the Spirit of God.
The Holy Ghost after Pentecost. Remember that. The Holy Ghost after Pentecost that baptizes a believer includes in itself the Father and the Son, the Spirit of the Father and the Son.
But my question is, why the scripture in Matthew chapter 1 verse 20, the Holy Ghost is already used in Matthew chapter 1 verse 20?
Well, no problem, because I'm not using the old reasoning I did when I first came to Cogeo. The old reasoning I did, the word ghost refers to a man, so the Holy Ghost is different from the Holy Spirit. You know that's a play on words. Let me explain that part. The word Holy Spirit is rendered in the Old Testament because they copied it from a Masoretic text, Hebrew text. The word ghost was used in the New Testament because they were copying from a Greek text.
Amen.
That's why the difference. Now, if I'm going to pursue my ill-advised strategy of saying the word ghost refers to spirit of man, I can still do that. My reasoning would be that when the New Testament was written, they already got used to the term Holy Ghost after Pentecost. That's the Holy Ghost they know. Okay, Matthew was asked for that. So, they got used to the word Holy Ghost, which includes man. Even though the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost was still forming Jesus in the womb of Mary, they got used to the term. Another example is the word serpent. In Genesis chapter 3 verse 1, the serpent was more subtle than the enemy is in the field. But did you know the word serpent means crawling? Creepy? If the word serpent means crawling and creepy, it is a flashback term. Moses got used to calling it serpent because it was already a crawling serpent. So, he still used the word serpent before it was cursed to crawl. There's nothing wrong with that. You just need to understand the word is retroactive. Or shall we say, it's not retroactive. It's the word we are just going flashback into time, what he was before. The same thing, the Holy Ghost for the child, child of the Holy Ghost. So that would be my explanation if I'm going to insist on the terminology. But I don't insist on the terminology anymore because it takes so much time. To put it simply, it was a different, just a difference of Hebrew and Greek rendering from the original text. So other question? Other Peter?
My question is regarding the parable of the wicked monkey, Pastor.
Wedding banquet. Matthew chapter 22.
We don't get what the fourth thing. Because if we read that Jesus said that he said much to the people which I believe regarding or referring to the Israelites. And then the people were just alibiing that they have farms to be cultivated, and they have business to be thinking. Well, I don't say farms will be eaten. That's why the king was angered. And he sent his armies to destroy that nation. And I believe that nation was rather than Israelite, where they were being destroyed in the year 1780. There was another servant sent by the king. And he said that, go to the highway, to the street, and invite the people, because they will be friendly. And when the place where really poor people, they saw one man
without a wedding garment.
Without a wedding garment.
So is that your question?
And my question is this. What is that wedding garment, which is very important in order for him to enter into the living monkey? Because that man was
outside, yes, yes.
Time is
fit
and matter.
So, let me answer.
What is the
wedding garment? And what does it represent?
Why did the...
Was person thrown out?
Yes.
Okay.
Why did Jesus Christ say that many are called,
but few are chosen?
But few are chosen. Who is the chosen one? Where he is the only one who can enter into that
wedding? So, let me answer the last question first. Many are called, God's grace is open for everyone. But few are chosen because few would beckon the call. Few would heed the call. Remember in the wedding banquet, open it up in Matthew chapter 22, read it by yourselves right now, here, in your seats. They called privileged people. They called to middle class people. They were ignored. Sometimes they called on to poor people, they were ignored. Those outcasts of the society were the ones who responded to his call. So many are called, but few are chosen. God's door is open, God's grace is open for everyone, but not everyone wants God's grace. Now, to answer the second question, why was the man thrown out? Well, the answer, of course, he does not have a wedding garment. The first question, what does the wedding garment represent? It represents Revelation chapter 3, verse 18, I think. Wherein, did I get it right? Buy from me white raiment, that thy nakedness would not appear. Why is the statement like that? Be white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, let the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. You can zoom in there so you can read it. Now, it goes back to the fall of man. Same thing. Now, in the first church age, in the first church, Ephesus, I will grant to him to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. He goes still go back in the beginning, where he fell. What was there when Adam and Eve covered up their nakedness? What was that? Human self-righteousness. It is as filthy rags. What verse is that? Our righteousness is our just as filthy rags. Isaiah what? 64:6. Thank you.
Filthy rags.
So, righteousness means reasoning. You know logos, that means reason. You have your own logos, you have your own righteousness, you have your own reason. They are the seal age. God, people has their own people's right, people's own righteousness, people's own reasoning. You have your own righteousness versus God's righteousness. You wanted the fig leaf instead of him giving you the
white raiment.
No, the sheep's skin. Coat skins. It represented Christ, that covering. So that covering, that your nakedness would not appear, had something to do with our apologetic word of God. You say apologetic. Reasoning with the scriptures.
Amen.
Sometimes you hold the scriptures without reason. It's out of context. You just added your idea on it. You are exposed. You are naked. You don't have any answer. A Nicolaitan would not want to humble down and check out other people's evidence. He just avoids. Sorry, brother. He just makes an excuse to get out of that situation when he's being contented with the truth. That is nakedness. You don't have any answer. Adam and Eve has no answer. They are ashamed. They're ashamed to look at God. That is what represents the white raiment. And here in Revelation, the wedding garment, fine linen and clean and true, was for the bride that would become his wife. When the bride would become his wife, the called ones become the chosen ones because they have graduated from that struggle. They overcame. So that wedding garment represents your overcoming all the trials, the temptations, all the struggles, and you are worthy to be wed to his son. If you don't have a wedding garment, then you are not worthy to be in the wedding. As simple as that. And you are thrown out. Like the foolish virgins, they did not have an image for oil. They were thrown out into outer darkness. If you don't have a wedding garment, you don't have any reason. You don't have God's righteousness in you. You may have your own righteousness like a fig leaf. Can fig leaf cover your nakedness completely? Huh? Today's culture, they're even removing the clothes. So, wedding garment represents God's righteousness, and if you don't have God's righteousness in you, you don't have God's logos in you, you don't have Christ, which is God's righteousness, our peace, then you don't have your peace with God. You're not worthy. And in that typology, there is the guest chamber, where they would bathe and wear the wedding garment. Where is the guest chamber? Our pastor before taught that the guest chamber is the church. Well, I'm not against that, that's correct. But let's go more detail. The guest chamber is a training room. A class orientation training. Whether it's one-on-one, or whether it's a class, it's a reckoning session.
Amen.
That's the guest chamber. Yes. Let me give you something about guest chamber Brother Branham talked about. I will meet you behind the tent. It will just be between you and me, not everyone else. This is not made for public. Now, if you have a private counseling or a class, you are encountering God through the Word, through His instructions. Many don't realize, they just look upon the person carnally. But we are just teachers, relationship, and I'm tired, I'm not tired, like a schoolboy does not study. But if you look at it, it is God. You know the Catholics before? They're so sincere, they look upon the priest as though it is God. If the priest absolves their sins are absolved. If the priest tells them, pray 10 Hail Marys.
They prayed.
They follow him to the letter.
Yes.
John 20:23. If he remit their sins are remitted unto them. To whomever sins he remit, they could remit sins. That's the power. You have the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bound on earth shall be bound in heaven. That's the power you have, says the power of the papacy. What's wrong with the papacy? There's nothing wrong with the power of earth. What's wrong is the message. Did you get it right? You see Nicolaita or Berea? So if you got the message wrong, whatever power you wield, it's a deception. But there are really power. You're a simple man. You're not rich enough. You don't look some respectable person. Sometimes you don't even bathe. But John the Baptist. But if you're Berean, let's say we are Berean, we are the truth, and there are Nicolaitan persons teaching certain truths, and we absorb them. That's the kind of humility God expects. Even if the person is a false prophet, like Herod, the Herodians, but the wise men got the information from them.
Amen.
You buy your dictionaries, you buy your commentaries, there's nothing wrong with them. They have histories. You compare, you prove. Not the instruction of most pastors, avoid them. They are denominational, they are Trinitarians, they are error. Mark the hymn. Brother Amos, I told him, he can look up other dictionaries, but he's so angry if I ask him, Brother God or Brother Frank.
Amen. Yes.
So, what is that key? So that key that you could have the power to remit sins is so simple that even a man that you could disrespect might have the power. A person who is buried, he could recognize from any person, even from a child.
Amen.
Even from a child, reporting from what he read, he studied, sometimes could benefit you. Amen?
Amen.
How many have experienced that? You learned something from what your children have reported. Those who have experienced that, say amen.
Amen.
I myself, I'm one. I heard from them, the children, something I never read before. And it helped me. You can learn from a child. It's because you're not looking at the flesh, you're looking at the word, the carrier of the word. So we're talking about remitting sins. How were your sins remitted? How were you given with a wedding garment? Because you were in a guest chamber. The guest chamber prepares you for the wedding. You remember Vashti? She stated to be prepared, but she rejected the king. So it was Esther who was being prepared. Who are her preparers? It's called the angels, typologically, but they are ministers of the word. They may not be perfect, but God uses them. If you have the right heart, being Berean, God will use those false and true anointed ones. The false are many, the true are few. Just to say, God uses everything to perfect you. And you get the right message. And you get the wedding garment in time.
10 minutes.
Okay. Other questions?
10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Before 10.
What's your question?
10 p.m.
10 p.m? Ah, okay. Time's up. Okay.
So 10 minutes. 10 minutes.
10 minutes? Any questions? Sister. Irish.
Good evening. My question is about for Christmas.
Yes.
Sister Angelica, please write down her question so I can post it. Please post the question or the transcript you have taken also. That's your next assignment for all of you. Okay, sis.
Are we okay to celebrate Christmas even though we are sharing the word of God?
Well, if you have the right Christmas. What is the right Christmas? Christ for the masses. But if you don't really have Christ for the masses, you only have the word, you even make it into an X. Well, you don't have really Christ, you're just using his name.
Xmas.
So, can you share the gospel and celebrate Christmas? If you know the right Christmas, you celebrate the right Christmas.
Amen.
Let me go into detail. The right Christmas is not in the gift. We just sang the song. We haven't sang that song again. We have a reason. You were not there. We sang that in the church in the morning. So, the true reason, the right Christmas, is not in gifts, decorations, parties, sometimes orgies, sometimes debaucheries, drunkenness, wantonness. They do that
yes.
On Christmas.
Yes, yes.
How low has it dropped the word? Their lips praise me, but their hearts are far from me.
Amen.
Might as well not use the word Christmas. So, those who celebrate Christmas, it even has pushed someone else to say the word Christ is pagan. Yes, I mean Christmas, because Christ is not the real word, not the right word. It should be Messiah, Mashiach, or whatever. So, the right celebration of Christmas, you have to know Christ the right way, the biblical way. How do you celebrate Christmas? Can you have feasts of food? Yes. But what should not disappear?
The word.
The progressive word.
Amen.
Not the liturgical word, traditional word in a litany, but the progressive word, you talk about it, you share about it. Later, after we dismiss, if you're still awake, take note of your friends, your wives, your children. Do they talk about things they don't know about the Word of God? Follow that excitement until you go to sleep.
Amen.
Elders have that excitement. Can parents transfer that excitement to their children? Yes, they can. That's one. That's the right one. What kind of other celebration? Can you see carols in houses? Brother Peter, can you sing carols, carolings? Can you do carolings? Brother George, yes or no? Do you need that attend earlier in the morning? Can you, Brother Peter, can you sing carolings? Sometimes, okay. Sister Chin, can you sing, is it alright to sing carols? Sister Chin, is it alright? To do caroling?
Yes.
You were there. So you're just an eagle praying upon the tree. Taking. Sister Angelica, is it alright to sing caroling? Yes or no?
Yes.
I don't know her reason. So, yes, in the right way. What is caroling? Singing. It's not asking for money, exactly. But they just use to get asking for money. Using caroling to ask for money. They use caroling to evangelize, give them tracts.
Amen.
And that's the right way to celebrate. Later on, after we dismiss. Oh, take note. That's the only time we can manifest interview sharing setups. Gather the young people who are still awake. Partner them with some
5 minutes. Five minutes?
Okay. So, that's the right way of celebrating. I hope you take note of it. Sister Angelica, give me the paper a little while after this. Next question. No more question. No more question? Others? Brother George.
Last question. Last question.
You have a, do you have a question? No? Okay, Brother George.
About the 144,000 is the combination of the Gentile.
144,000 has already been mentioned in Revelation chapter 7. Then he mentioned the mixed multitude. It's another group. It's parallel to them. They're martyrs in the tribulation period. The Jews are more special than the Gentiles. When you read Jew and Gentile, God is more respected.
Amen.
Just because one knows more information than the other. Who is the doer of the word? Okay, so there are foolish virgins who are non-Jews. I just told you, is the word non-Jews. They are as precious to God as those who have the love. God bless us. Let's give God a big hand.